when he is old, he will not depart from it. I trust my Bible. How many of you trust your Bible? How many trust that the Word of God, infallible? That's the authority that we live under. Amen? Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we just thank you. We just praise you, Father, for being here with us. And Father, we thank you for just having me here at the service, Father, and being a blessing to him. Father, we pray that your Spirit, Father, moves strong, and it moves completely through this room, Father, touching and anointing, Father, those that are sick, Father. Let them be healed, Father. Those that have been carrying burdens, Father, and I feel a lot of burdens that they've been carrying, Father, we pray those burdens are laid on you, Father, and that they are lifted off of their shoulders, Father. Those that have been depressed, Father, we pray, Father, that depression leaves in Jesus' name. Father, today, Father, we will pray. Today, Father, we will believe with one another. And, Father, today we agree in one accord that they are healed, that they are delivered. Father, that every financial need is met, Father, and that when it looks impossible, Father, they understand that's when you start moving on their behalf. Amen? Amen. I was praying over what to the Lord had for you today, and I tell you what, the word the Lord gave me, with just one simple word, it wasn't something like, oh, wow, sometimes I get a revelation on a scripture. How many of us do that when we're reading and we're studying and you read the Bible and, oh, it sounds different. That scripture looks different today, and he's like downloading from the Lord. And I was praying over this before we came here, and then even yesterday as I was just meditating on the Lord. And the word God gave me for you, for this church today, just one word, and that is fight. That is fight. And all I can remember in my spirit was my pastor, John Osteen. And when John Osteen, we used to always preach and preach and preach, but when John would get going, he would quote this very simple poem, and he'd have his hands crossed, and he's walking across the stage at Lakewood Church, and John would say, "Great it is to dream the dream when you start in youth at the starry stream, but a greater thing it is to fight life through. Fight, 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 fight life through. Great it is to fight, fight, fight life through, and at the end to say the dream is true." Come on. How many of us had dreams? How many of us have vision? How many of us want today to be better than yesterday? Come on. How many of us look at life and say, "I need more"? Come on. Jesus said, "I have come that you may have life and that you may live more abundantly." Amen? So if Jesus said it, and I don't know about you, but abundance to me means more than enough. You know, I tell everybody the Bible says that when you give, a liberal giver is made fat. Do we need to describe in America what fat is? It's an excess. Come on. It's not fitting in the pants anymore. It's like, "Hey, did you shrink my shirt?" I always complain to my wife. "Did you shrink this shirt again? Look, it's too small on me. Did you?" "No, that's one of your older shirts." But you know, that's what fat does. Fat makes things not fit. Amen? Abundance makes things overflow. What does the Bible say? He said, "My cup runneth over for you." Amen? Shaken together, pressed down, and running over for you. How many of us needs their cup running over right now? How many of us need something more? All I hear in my spirit is fight. This is not a time in our walk to be complacent with our faith. This is a time that the enemy has become aggressive. The enemy has become stronger in our political government. The enemy has become stronger even in our own churches. Today, even top ministers aren't saying what is wrong and what is right. How many of us will follow God even to our own hurt? How many of us would take a challenge and say, "I believe. I believe what the Bible says"? You know, we all remember those videos. Pastor Jack, I'm pretty sure that you've seen those videos too. Remember the videos of the rapture? And they would scare me and my brother. They'd have that video playing. It was an old one. And you see these guys driving up to a church in an army vehicle. And then they're grabbing people out of the church. And they're like cutting them up and mutilating them, torturing them to renounce Christ. And you know what? You think these are believers. You know, that's happening now in the spirit. And we ain't got to wait for someone to come and open the door and drag us out. We're being persecuted. We're being ridiculed. We're being gagged. Our voice is not being heard. I mean, we're in Independence, right? Independence Weekend is the most proudest day for Americans. It should be. It was founded on a Christian principle. And it was, if you don't know this, it was founded because God seen us fit to found this nation to save his Jews, to save the Jews. He made this country possible to be a blessing to the Jewish nation. He made this country that we would go into a war and fight for them and get them from being annihilated. He purposed in his heart before Hitler even hit over there in Germany and taking all, trying to kill and get rid of all the Jews. God knew this would happen, and he found a nation, a place that he can plant a seed of faith and see it grow and be built up to a godly nation. I had this gentleman on the plane. One day we're flying out. I was going into Atlanta. I seem like I'm always going into Atlanta because it's always connecting everywhere. But he was on the plane, and I was talking to him, and they give you these little cookies, and I had like extra cookies. I always get extra ones. And he looked at me. He kept looking at the cookies. I go, "You want the cookie?" He looked like a grouchy old man. You know, you get the grouchy ones on the plane. People just like the personal space. And I mean, you're on a plane. You don't got much personal space. Please, come on. Some people are too temperamental. And he looked at me. He goes, "Thanks." And I asked him what he did, and he told me he worked for the airlines for building these big assembly things for the planes. And I told him I was a minister and stuff. And I was like, "Oh, I hate saying that sometimes," because honestly, the reaction today you get is like, "What?" But most time it's because I'm all smiling. I just smile so much. I'm like, "Yeah, I preach the word." I usually start off with, "I'm a broadcaster for Christian television," and then I go into, "I'm a minister." And he looked at me, and he just stood quiet. To me, it's not my main goal to try and get them saved that minute. But I will if they want to talk about the Lord. I will, but I just try and see where their heart is. And you know, most of the people I run into, their heart, I don't know where their souls are, right? But I know their hearts are good. The people that I run to talk about the Lord. And he was one that was in the wars. And I didn't know this. And he started sharing. And it was so passionate. Because you could tell this guy how he talked and just his language and stuff. He was not a Christian. And to my eyes, if I was sitting there trying to judge, who are we to judge, right? But he looked at me. And I go, "Wow, I follow the Lord." And he just stood quiet. And he goes, "You know what?" He goes, "I was on my first plane ride in the Army or in the Air Force flying in. I was parachuting because we had a helicopter go down." And he just started to cry. And he was with me. He was with me. My parachute didn't open. I fell into a building, rode out of the building, from the top of the building, fell on the, he didn't say how high the building was, but it's a building. He goes, and it crushed my leg. He goes, "Not only that," he goes, "I got through that, but then I was still able to serve." He goes, "And then we had to go out and get some more people out of this bunker, and we got trapped in another building." And this was a year later. I'm in this building. He goes, and he looked at me, "Son," and he started crying. He goes, and he was there. He was there. He goes, "The building came down on me," because that's the only way they could get the sniper, is they had to bring the building down. He goes, "They didn't know we were inside, because the sniper is picking off a lot of troops, and they had to take the building down. They called it airstrike. They pulled me out of the rubble, and he was there." And then this is a guy that you would not think that he had that much faith in him. You would not. And this guy just starts telling me these stories. He goes, "I was in a car wreck, and everybody died, but he was there for me." He said he was there. And I looked at that, and he just looked at me, and the tears are welting up. He goes, "My daughter's going through this, through MS. And he goes, "And every day we work on her, and every day we help her." He just put his head down, and he's not ashamed. I'm not going to argue with the guy. He just started to cry, and he goes, "He is there. He is there." And he started crying. And then we prayed for his daughter. And he goes, "Look," and he goes, he pulled up his pant leg, and he had a metal leg from his waist down. And he said this, he goes, "I've had this leg after the war," he goes, "and I walk every day and I look at that leg and I say, I just lost a leg. That's all I did." Because he was there. You know, it always could be worse. Amen? Life could always be harder. Man, don't tempt that devil to come fight harder in your life. Life could always be harder. It can't, but God's grace is so sufficient for all our needs. Amen? And then when we finished talking and stuff, he opened up his shirt and he pulled out some dog tags. And he goes, I've always had this with me. And on the back of the dog tags was a cross. He sketched in a cross. He goes, I've never take it off. Even in security, he goes, I never take it off. When they tell me to take it off, he goes, I will never take it off. He goes, because since I've put this on there, that cross, he goes, he has been there for me. So when we look at life and we see all the troubles that we have, think of the people that are probably going through something a bit worse. Amen? And just think that you have to fight. I looked at him and I could see one thing people notice is when you see a fighter. That man was a fighter. How hard is it to lose a limb? How hard is it to be waiting under rubble? How hard is it and still believe that God is there? You see, God gives us so much that we have to unlock it in the Word of God. We have to pray. This is not a season to not pray. This is not a season to stop coming to church. This is a season that we need to come in the house of God and ask God what to do. Because right now, as parents, all right, as husbands and wives, and as workers at work, and just in general, we're facing things we've never had to face before. Our predecessors hadn't had to face. Everyone that was before us in faith didn't have to face what we're seeing today. The internet changed everything. The selfies, Facebook time changed everything. I told you the last time I was here, there's no other time in history, no other time ever that Jesus could have came back till now. Because in a twinkling of an eye, in the very second that he appears, someone's going to take a selfie with Jesus. Come on. There's JC up there. It's going to be on someone's Facebook. Till they realize they didn't go. It's like, whoa, wait a minute. This is the only time in the middle of India. In the middle of India. Now, I do not know where this man had his cell phone. But he had a little towel around him. And he's just sitting down. The phone rings. I'm walking by. I can't get coverage in India. And this man's phone rings, and he's talking on the phone. You're right, hello, yes, yes. And I'm like looking. All of my people that I take care of in India, the friends and a lot of the ministers that we work with, we work off Facebook. Because no matter where they can't get like a strong internet connection, but they can use their phone, and I'm messaging them back and forth instantly. I'm talking to someone in a second in India. No time ever. Was that possible? Till now. So remember what the Word of God says in the last days. The devil knows. The devil knows. And I'm not trying to scare you. We're going to go a little bit over some more scriptures. But the devil knows his time is short. And he's coming after your family. I'm going to tell you something. If you don't know this, you will know this right now. The devil hates you. The devil wants to kill you. The devil wants to kill your family. He wants to destroy anything that has the scent of God on it. Am I telling you something you didn't know? Am I telling you something that's new? If we didn't know it, we need to know it today. He is coming after anyone. The three times we see the devil in the Bible that talked about the devil, that the devil actually spoke and said something and it was recorded in the Word of God. The three times we seen him was in Genesis, where he came to deceive. And when he came to Jesus and tempted him in the Garden of Gethsemane, three times we see the devil. And all he did was lie, manipulate, tempt, deceive, and try to destroy our very salvation, which is Jesus Christ. He tried to take what was incorruptible and make it corruptible. But oh, the Word of God, Jesus, even Jesus had to go back to the Word of God and said, it is written. If you don't know your Bible, you better get to know your Bible. I tell you, if it wasn't for the years of the military, oh, Lord, that's like 22 years ago, or 20, yeah, 20, 20 years ago, 22 years ago. It's a long time for me. And I stood in that word, 13 chapters a day. No matter if I was tired, no matter if I was hungry, I would read the word of God because I knew I was in a place that was ungodly. And if I wanted to get godly, I had to read the word of God and keep my mind because it wasn't me. My heart always loved God. No matter where I was since I was a child, I loved God. But the thing, the difference is to keep your mind on God. That's the biggest difference. Is you can love God, but if your mind doesn't stay on God. You know, before we only had 7 channels or 8 channels to watch. Can you remember that? Good Lord, am I dating myself or what? Who can remember when there was only like trying to get that picture clear? Now there's like 100 and something all day. And I'm not saying you're doing anything wrong watching TV. No, but I'm saying make your priorities right. Spend time with God.
I have to honestly step back a little and say, if I wasn't always preaching or if I wasn't always doing television or radio, would I be in this as much?
Probably not, especially with the World Cup going on right now. Honestly, certain things will distract you, things you like to do, which aren't wrong. But we got to focus on what God has for us. We got to focus on how God has it for us. Amen? He has a plan. He said, if you follow this word, the Bible says this, if you follow this word and understand, if you do what I say, I'm going to bless you. Isn't that what it says? You can read all of Genesis and Deuteronomy. It speaks through all of that. If you follow my precepts, line upon line, here a little, there a little, you get that in you, God's going to do something for you. You see, there's faith. And then over here, there's fear. The devil's going to create fear in your life. Whatever you believe, you receive. If you feed fear, you receive what fear has. If you feed faith, you receive what faith has for you. You see, there's so many of us, and I'm going to say it, that could do more. Because the Bible tells us that we can do more. The Bible says that we're supposed to go and lay hands on the sick, that they shall recover. I got to tell you, I've visited large churches, and I've visited small churches and medium-sized churches. And each of them, when I go in, most of them, hardly have prayer at the altars, or they hardly have healing services. I was in a large church, and they love me to death. They love me. They tell me, we want you back once a year to come and do healing services. I'm like, great. But the line's always so big. That tells me that no one else is coming in and doing healing services for them. But are they supposed to wait for me to come in and do that? Hey, I'm honored. I'll go and I know it's not me. You know, I know it's the faith that's created in that room that heals them. Amen? It's Jesus and believing, and me just believing the word of God and seeing God just operate. That's what God does it. But you're supposed to do it. Amen? Right? You're supposed to go out there and preach the gospel. You're supposed to be that witness. There's going to be times like Smith Wigglesworth's time when he's in a train and the next train gets completely healed. Come on. I'm going to tell you a story right now. Almost 22 years ago maybe, just out of the military, I was with this ministry in India. And we weren't in India, but I was traveling around. We had American pastors go into India in a place called Badapada. And try and say that 7 times, Badapada. But anyway, we went over there, and it's Orissa State. And when they went to go and preach and stuff, they got locked up. You gotta follow the rules if you're in another country, first of all. And we told them, do not leave the church to pray for people. And one guy thought he was Mahatma Gandhi for some reason. And he said, I'm here to deliver the Indian people. And he went outside. And a mob of Hindus took him. He walked outside, gone. Another guy, gone. Went to help him, gone. Well, everybody went to help him, and we found them all in jail, praying because they were arrested for praying for the sick outside. It's against the law. Against the law in India at that time. Still against the law. If you do it right, you stay inside, you're fine.
I'm maybe in my early 20s. I get a call at the office in the middle of the night. Tells me I need to help them because they got arrested, and I have one of our Indian contacts calling me. Within 2 weeks, I'm on ABC, CBS, and back then there wasn't all the Fox networks and CNN and all that. Maybe they're just starting up, I guess. But it wasn't as available. And I'm doing press conference after press conference. Young man, 20-something. And I'm helping them. And I don't get no sleep. I hardly even eat for 2 weeks. We get them released. You know, and I'm thinking, wow, that's amazing. And everybody thought after that for me, that, oh, your ministry's launching. It's taking off at 20. And I'm like, well, that's neat. But, you know, 20 years later, I'm standing here in front of you. It never took off. It never just flourished because there was a season. How about everybody say season? There's a season when God does things that he will use you at a moment to be a blessing to someone. Amen? And God will use you. Don't ever get discouraged when that season ends. Just continue to follow God and another season will open up for you. I'm here to encourage you. I'm here to make you say things are going to be okay. You know, 20 years later, 22 years later, I finally go to India. I sold in India, and I told you this last time. I sold in India, funding them, working with them, sweating there for over 15 years before I even went myself. Because I just believe that I'm going to be a blessing and help them. How many of us can do that? How many of us can just be a blessing, not even go on ourselves? King David said, those that go into battle and those that watch the goods receive the same reward in heaven. You know, it's very true. It will receive the same reward, which means when they take them to another country, whatever that reward they bring back, they still split it up equally for those that sit there. Spiritually, that means no matter if you send or you go, you receive the same reward in heaven. It's like you were going yourself. So 15 years later, I'm finally going to India. About 5 years later, going to India, I'm finally in this little city. I don't even know what it is. I'm sitting there. The place is packed. It was just a little bit bigger than this building. 500 Indians in there, crammed in there. And the whole place is almost cement from top to bottom. Even the pulpit was cement in the front. I'm looking at these guys, and then I'm sitting there, and I'm reading the banner behind me, and it says Bada Pada. And I looked at my translator, my head of the ministry. When we go out there, he takes care of me. He's the guy that takes care of all our stuff out there, and he's our crusade coordinator. And I'm like, "You brought me to Bada Pada?" He goes, "Yes, I'm sorry." I go, "You know what happened in Bada Pada?" "Yes." I go, I had a wanted name on me in Bada Pada from years back. I'm not even in that country, and they put my name on a wanted list as well. I mean, I'm helping them get released, but I never even stepped foot. They have my name on a register if I ever go in there to arrest me. I'm like, "Dude, I'm going to get arrested. Are you crazy?" And he's like, no, it's okay. It's okay. We give them little. They're fine. I'm like, oh, my goodness. So I go up there, and I look. When you sow your seeds and you invest in God's kingdom, God knows your heart. It may not be a lot. It may be just a little. Whatever you do for God, there's something good that comes out of it. Amen? When I went up there, that was one of the most breakthrough sessions in healing services that we had in India. One of the most breakthrough sessions, 500 people in the building. I couldn't even pray for the people. I had to sit back and I jumped over the thing to go pray and lay hands on the sick. We couldn't even form lines. We couldn't do anything. And then as soon as I stepped over the pulpit area, and it was like a long leap, but I was younger then and I could do that leap. I jumped over there and all of a sudden it was like, you see, it's like a movie. I'm like, no, the whole crowd, even though they're small, like ants, together, they're really strong. And I'm like, oh, I just jumped over. The guest preacher, the healing minister, is jumping over a platform, rolling on the floor. And all you hear is a thud, right, like hits the wall hard. That all those bodies wanted to get prayed for. They were so excited in faith. And that's actually where I learned about the excitement of faith and what it can do for a city. How Jesus would walk into a city and everybody would get healed because of the excitement that they knew the healer was there. There's a level that each one of us can create in faith that God could do something so tremendously. And as I looked at them, I'm like, how am I going to pray? So I looked at the window, and I looked at my guys, I said, Lord, I think I know what I'm doing. Let's go. I followed the Holy Spirit on what we're doing. I took two guys with me, one with the microphone, and they had a cordless, went to the front of the church, climbed out the window, went to the front of the church, opened the door, and I said, you tell them we're going to take about 300 people out of here, and I'm going to lay hands on them as they go. And as they go, God will heal them. And then once we get to 200, we can get in there and we can do the normal things we do. But we can't pray for that people and be safe. And we'll just trust God that God's going to heal them. You know, it's what God does, not what I do. Amen? I'm just obedient. God does the healing. 300 went out. We shut the doors, went inside, prayed for the other 200. I'm back at my hotel. Get back home. I get a phone call. We had 500 in the room. I get a phone call that 1,000 people got healed that night. Everybody inside the entire building was healed. Everybody in the building was sick. Everybody got healed. The loudspeakers were playing on the outside of the church. They had like bullhorns. They're all playing. And the people outside that were Hindu, Muslim, and Christian were completely healed. 1,000 people got healed. And I believe it's because I sowed a seed 15 years ago caring for these ministers that were American ministers and locked up, and I took hell. But I fought. I fought in faith for them that God produced. I reaped what I sowed. Amen? How many of us know sowing and reaping? We know that principle? Wave your hands if you know the principle of sowing and reaping. You know, if sowing and reaping is wrong, then God himself is wrong. Because I tell you what, he took Jesus. He wanted you. He wanted you. He wanted you. And he took Jesus, and the only thing that he had, when you sow stuff, you can't sow an orange and get an apple. You got to sow an apple to get an apple. Am I right? If he wants a human, he has to sow a human. He had to sow Jesus into the ground. 3 days. Even God himself had to wait 3 days till he could receive what he's sown. God himself is bound to the principle of sowing and reaping. It takes time for a blessing to come in. Amen? It takes time for something to happen. And when Jesus came up, guess what? He received us. And he received all of us as the harvest from the seed that God sown. But get this. And I'll tell you how God's principle of sowing and reaping works. Seed keeps giving, and today God is still reaping from the seed that he's sown. Can you get that in your spirit? You got to get it in your spirit when you give and how it receives. And that's just not in finances, but in everything you do. In everything you do. You know, the first few years doing the India trips, they were hard. I mean, I'm taking two planes just to get overseas. I'm taking to have to wait a day and take another plane for another hour and a half, 2 hours out there to where the capital is, the state that we go into. And then I'm taking a 5-hour car ride or 6-hour train ride down to our base. And then from the base, we're going 3 or 4 hours in the jungle, sometimes 6 hours in the jungle. That's a lot of travel. And then we got to come back and do the same thing. It was hard. And when I'm out there preaching, there are probably like 40 people sometimes in the little tents. 80 people sometimes, maybe 100 in the first few years. And I had to nod my head and say, is it worth it? Come on, who wouldn't sit back and think, is it worth it? And I'm looking at this, and I'm like, well, I just don't know. And I just kept going. I kept faithful. I felt the call in my heart. But I fought through that. How many of us can look at things and we don't see the production that needs to be? And when we look at it and we see where it's at and we look at it and say, man, I don't know if this is working out. How many of you look back? You got to step back and analyze it. You got to see what's happening. And when I did that, I just kept believing God was to do it. And after 4 years of pressing and pressing and pressing and keep going faithfully, God rewards faithfulness. Come on. He will reward faithfulness. After 4 years of going on these long trips, we started seeing miracles. I mean, not just one or two miracles. Not just something just happened here and happened there. No, we start seeing biblical miracles. In one city, one little village, I lined up 25 blind people. 25 blind people. I didn't even know there were 25 blind people in the room. I just said, anyone that's blind, come up. My friends looked at me that had ministers with me, and they're like, are you serious? They were, yeah, bring all the blind people up. God was doing something, amen? God was doing something. He went to touch them. 25 of them line up. I told my team that was with me, I go, I don't want you touching them. I don't want you laying hands on them. I just want you to walk by them. I'm going to walk by them last. And I walked by them, went back on the stage. I said, I'm going to count to three. I had them close their eyes. I said, I'm going to count to three. On three, I want you to open your eyes. I go, one, two, three. 24 of them opened their eyes and were healed. The 25th one wasn't. 24 of them instantly opened their eyes. And they hadn't been able to see for I don't know how long, but they're just crying and crying and thanking the Lord. Those are the miracles we're seeing. The one, that, the 25th one believed that her sickness was from God and that she didn't need to be healed because that's how she reaches people with her testimony. I'm like, woman, don't you think it'd be better if you could read the Bible? I mean, goodness, how many more people you can help if you can actually read the words? Anyway, so she was the one that, and all my ministers went over there, start praying for her, and like, how about, how about? I'm like, you know, they got real charismatic, and I'm like, brothers, there's so many more people. Save your energy for people that want to be healed. Come on, people think I'm rude or cruel when I'm on the road like that, but I listen to. I'm in spirit zone. I'm just listening to the Spirit the whole time. Listening to the Spirit the whole time. I think I told you this last time. I'll tell it to you again. God will use you wherever you're at. Amen? He is looking. The Bible says that he looks to and fro, all over the place. The Spirit is searching for a heart that wants to do his work. I'm paraphrasing it, but that is what God does. The Spirit is moving about. There was this man that was laying on the floor. I never even remember this. I didn't even remember this. I learned this on my radio show. We're doing a live radio show, and I asked one of the ministers, what was your favorite miracle that happened? What was the thing that really, really just, I mean, I know there are plenty, and it's hard to pick one, but if you had a favorite one, tell me it. And the pastor's like, well, Brother David, this miracle, it was something that you were a part of. And I'm like, really? I'm like, cool. And I thought it was going to be like the 25 blind people, because I thought that was the most awesome thing I've seen. And because you just don't see that. Not every day. And instantly like that. He goes, no, it was when you prayed for the man on the street. I'm like thinking, well, I know the rules. I never pray on the street. I'm thinking, are you sure that was me? And he's like, yeah. He goes, you were asleep. And as the Jeep was driving, you talked in Hindi to the driver to stop. And you jumped out of the car and ran across the street. And the translator ran as fast as he could to catch up with you, but you were moving quick. And you got to a man that was laying on his back on the floor, all mangled and crippled. And you looked at him, and you talked to him in Hindi, and said, does he believe in Jesus? He said, I love Jesus with all my heart. Now get this. He goes, but no one's ever come and prayed for me. I go, do you believe that you can be healed? He goes, I believe with all my heart, and I'm understanding this guy, supposedly. And I'm like, okay. I go, well, if you believe, I got his hand. And I pulled him up, and they said visibly that they could see his body was crooked. And visibly they could see God changing it and making it straight. And he got his bed. I say, take your bed and walk. And go tell the people what the Lord has done for you. And he walked off. And then they said, I got back in the Jeep and I went to sleep. I didn't even know of this miracle. Did not know. But don't you see what God does? God knows who needs to be blessed. Amen? He will send someone to bless. He would send someone to help you in your time of need. He seen me driving in a Jeep. The Lord knew I was coming in that Jeep around the corner and knew that he could just do what he had to do with me to help that man. And you know what? God did it. It wasn't me. That is how strong we've seen things happen. But that was years and years of pushing through and really 20 years of supporting India and going now, 5 years, so 15, yeah, 20 years total. So that is the things that we have to see. I'm going to tell you, when you're going to do something for God, and when you're out there, you got to believe God sent you. You can never think for a shadow of doubt that you're not supposed to be there. I had a moment where I thought that for a second, and I was starting to get depressed. Come on. You're in a foreign country, 17 Indians or so inside the Jeep with you. 17 Indians in a Jeep. Hearing Indian music. And you're like sweating. They have AC. It costs extra. I'll pay you extra. Oh, so sorry. You're all like dying in this car And you start thinking, am I supposed to be there? I could be home eating a sandwich. I could be just resting in front of my TV. And then the moment that I about to slip into this depression, because it's anyone, how many of us know that any one of us can slip into it? Come on. Any one of us could slip in depression at any moment if we allow ourselves. If we don't gird up our loins, if we don't get into the Word of God and stand, as the Word of God says in Ephesians 6, 10 through 13, and stand. And after done all, stand. After you put on the full armor of God, stand. That is where we have to be in our faith. And I was getting there. Then all of a sudden, say, oh, I don't want to be here. I'm not even at the first conference yet. This is after a long, long trip. And I'm like, looking, this is my third year going in. 3 years going in already there at this when this happened. And I'm looking, and I see a big dump truck, look like a dump truck, but it's their diesels, pull up in front of us, and they have a sticker on the back that says, God is awesome. In India, of all places, God is awesome. I mean, you may see them here in Louisiana and all over the United States, but in India, to say God is awesome. And I knew that was referring to the God that we serve. My spirits were lifted. You know, David in the Bible, he fell into a depression as well. He started to fall. He started to fall into a depression because his men were so angry that they went into battle. And when they came back, all the goods were gone. Everything was taken. And they were blaming him, that they were even thinking of killing him. And what David did was seek the Lord. Come on, that's the best thing you can do when you're about to fall into a depression. And what the Word of God says is that he encouraged himself in the Lord. And he was able to take the turn that encouragement. You know what? We can do nothing without faith. Without faith, it is impossible to please God. Come on. And with faith, if you're pleasing God, God is going to be blessing you. Come on. His situation looked like it was going to turn bad, that he was going to die. How many have ever faced that? That you're about to die. But instead, he encouraged himself in the Word of God, got himself up and lifted, and his faith soars. And when your faith soars, you can take on any challenge. Amen? You can take on any challenge when your faith soars. Whatever you're going to go through, whatever course God sends you through in life, however God starts to direct you to get to your ministry, to get to what your blessing needs to be, we can never choose it. Amen? We can never choose the direction that God's going to take us. God just opens that door and we go through it. But we can choose the attitude that we're going to have when we're in that chapter of our life. Come on. We can be down and depressed, or we can be up and lifted and saying, I am more than a conqueror. God has great things for you. I hope I'm encouraged. I hope I'm reaching some of you that you just understand that no matter what, that fear has no place in your life. I'm going to tell you a few things real quick. I'll tell you, that's the Spirit of God, because a lot of this is pretty much what I was going to tell you, but I want to give you something here. Whenever you hear threats, come on. Whenever you have people try and make fear and try and threaten you, that's the devil. I hope you know that. Recently in my life, I had to stand up for something. I had to stand up for something. And I was threatened. I was threatened that, you know, government issues would come up. I was threatened that, and they're trying to make me fearful. And I was just doing this, going back in the corner, back in the corner, back in the corner. And they're saying, if you don't do this, you're going to be penalized. You're going to do this and that and that. And I'm not going into the details, but it started me going like this. And then this is in the middle of the night. And I got to a point where my faith's like, no, you fight. You fight. You fight. Because I knew I was right. I knew I was right. And I had to make the best choice for my family. And I said, you know what? I'm going to take this on. Because fear and threats don't motivate me. Come on. I do not take fear and threats to govern my life. If I was living that, I'd be in such a mess. But my faith got encouraged. And I stood up and I fought. And I said, no matter what, I don't care what you do, but we're doing it this way. And you know what? After 30 days, it's all over. But it takes you to stand up for your faith. In a country that has allowed the Muslim nation to come in and do whatever they want. You have to fight. You have to fight. I tell you, depression is going to hit anyone. Depression can hurt anyone. Depression can come after you at any time. I'm going to tell you about four people that in just celebrities and stuff, that people with wealth that just took their lives. There's a goalkeeper in Germany about 3 years back. Top prospect for Germany. One of the best goalkeepers. Played on Bayern Munich, one of the best teams. Making millions of dollars. Suffered depression. They don't know what came on him. I tell you what came on him. The enemy pressed him in. And as soon as you start getting depressed, it starts pulling you away from what's supposed to be encouraging to what's discouraging. And do you know one day he stepped in front of the commute train that comes to cross. He just jumped in front of it. Took his life. There was an actor just recently, a year ago, on a very successful TV show, and he just said that's it. They couldn't find him. He didn't come to his casting, his call to do his lines and stuff. They had to send someone to go find him. When they found him, he was dead. He killed himself at his home. Finances were good. Everything was good. They just said they don't know what happened. They don't know what happened. Then there's a director, won the Oscar 2 years ago. 2 years ago, won the Oscar for Best Documentary. Oscar, that's like the highest plateau you can win in the film industry. That means, hey, your career is going forward. He couldn't handle the pressure. He couldn't handle the expectations. 1 year later, on the anniversary date that he won his Oscar, he jumped, and he was in the Europe, he jumped off a bridge to a train and killed himself. He just did it. Depression will come after you at any time. It will come after you. Beautiful young actress that was on one of the Spider-Man movies in Europe, in the UK. She was one of the reporters on that movie. Promising young British actress. Everybody was getting her roles, and she was getting going, and her career was launching. She wasn't heard of for several days. They went to the family cottage, and they found her hanging from a ceiling fan. Depression is real. It's a problem. And the thing is, the word of God, I really believe, is the only thing. Encouraging words, sitting with people to know that there's other people that can help. There's other times to be blessed. We've never seen that much, but we're seeing it now. Remember I told you at the start that we're seeing things that we haven't seen before? This is one of the things we're seeing. This is one of the things. You know what the internet did? Even though it's very open and everybody's on it and there's always comments and everything under Yahoo and everything, there's hundreds of people commenting here and there, it's made a very seclusive people now. People will hide in their house on the internet, and that is their life. Salvation Army has said that there's no longer the corner is outside, but it's in the cyber world. There's a cyber corner that we're trying to reach. There's people that are depressed, that are hurting themselves. There's people that are prostituting. There's people that are just in a hard place in life, and they can't make good choices, but we can't get to them because they keep themselves secluded in their house. You may know some of those people. You need to go knock on their door. Just check on them. Ask if they need anything from you or you need to pray for them. I want to give you this scripture. Be sober and vigilant. Be sober and vigilant, for your adversary, the devil, roareth about like a roaring lion, seeking whom he may devour. You know, when I look at all the things we've done in ministry this last year, I look at I look at God's goodness. Amen? Be encouraged. He has great things for you. He has good things that he wants to put in your hand. Marilyn Hickey was on my show, on my radio show, about 2 years ago. And I asked her if she had just a few minutes to share the audience. Anything she wanted to share, just share. I mean, hey, got Marilyn Hickey, give her 10 minutes for herself. And she goes, you know what? She goes, I'm so glad you listened to the Spirit, because I have something for you. And this is for you. This is for you as well. She said, I have a scripture that God given me, and I want to give it to you. And I'm going to tell you what God is telling me. The scripture is calling to me, and I will answer thee and show you great and mighty things that thou knowest not. How many of us remember that scripture? Calling to me, and I will answer thee and show you great and mighty things that thou knowest not. But this is Second Chronicles 16, I think. When you listen to that just sounds great. But she goes, let me tell you how God is telling it to me to tell it to you. I love you. I want to spend time with you. Come spend a few minutes. Spend some time with me. Get to know me. I want to just love you. I want to give you things that you can never dream of. I have visions for you that you've never had the visions that I've had for you. I have things in my hand that I want to put in your hand, but I need some time with you. Come spend time with me, because I want to be a blessing to you. I want to answer your questions, and I want to give you a direction. Doesn't that sound more wonderful when you hear it like that? You know, when I look at that and I see what God's done, I can see how God has opened up more things if I spent more time. And I don't mean to sit hours and hours, but my mind is constantly on God. My prayer is always praying. I'm always praying in tongues here and there, just walking around, driving. My radio's beat up. It doesn't work in my truck. So I just talk to the Lord. If I'm not on the phone, I don't text while I'm driving. I'm always talking to the Lord. So if I hit someone, I hopefully pray, God, I was talking to you, Lord, take care of it. But I just talk to the Lord. I commune with him. You have to commune with God to get through the things that we're going through today. Let's everybody stand up if we could. You know, we cannot choose the route, but we can choose how we act when we're going through this stuff. Has the devil come into your life and said, there's no way out, like he looked at Joseph? Can you imagine Joseph? Imagine Joseph. We know Joseph in the Word. I'm a Word preacher. I love the Word of God. I'll preach the Word. I'll give you stories. But think of Joseph. Everything was going good for him. Everybody wanted to be like Joseph. His brothers envied him. He had the best coat, promising career in the early 20s, ready to go somewhere. And all of a sudden, his brothers decided that they wanted to kill him. That's an amazing thing. If you look at that story, you go and read that story. Four things happened to him. First, the devil came in and said, you're dead. We're going to kill you. Then he was in a pit after he got delivered from that. Then he was in a pit. And what does the pit tell him? There's no way out. You're going to stay here the rest of your life stuck in this thing. Then he got out of that. And then all of a sudden he was sold into bondage. We sold into bondage as your life is not your own. I'm telling you what to do. Has the devil come and whispered those things in your ears? And the things in life that you have? And then when he was doing everything right, and he never did anything wrong, but when he was just thinking this is going, this is about to happen, this is really going to be my breakthrough, the accuser comes in and accuses him of something he didn't do. Come on. Does that look like your life? Does that look like where, hey, I'm supposed to be here. I had great promise, but now it all fell apart in the last 20 years. I can tell you that I've seen Joseph's life in my life. I've seen where I felt that I could have been here, but it took time to get there. But you know what? The whole time, I tell you this, I never stopped praising him. I never stopped praising. It don't matter what song you sing, you just praise him. Praise him till you get your breakthrough. Amen. Today we're going to pray for you. If those that need prayer, we're going to pray that depression leaves. We're going to pray that healings happen. We'll pray that your financial need is met. Amen. But most of all, we're going to pray that you have a closer experience with God. Thank you so much for having me. Let us pray. Father, we just thank you, God. We pray right now your anointing be a blessing, Father, to these people, Father. They have diligently came and heard the word of God. Father, we pray for all the families here, all the babies here, Father, all the children here, Father, everyone in this house, in this home, Father, we pray right now. Father, the house of God is here, Lord, with just your children looking up to heaven. And Father, we pray that an anointing drops on them, that they are healed right now in Jesus' name. Their backs are healed, Father. Arthritis is healed, Father. Father, we scream at cancer and command it to leave. That fear will not come over this church or this people, Father. We believe in healing, Father. We believe in miracles, and we believe, Father, that they are set free today. Father, we take bondage, and I hear bondage is gone in Jesus' name, Father. Father, we command depression to leave, and the enemy and the spirit of depression to leave right now. Depression, we call you out of this place and cast you out right now. We cast you out of this place, and we put the blood of Jesus around this church that you can never come back in here again. That you can never come and attach yourself to their lives and try and manipulate and deceive. Father, we believe, Father, finances are met, Father, that they are blessed, that they can be a blessing to the house and the work of God. We pray, God, that the anointing hits them so strong, Father, in their heart, Father, that they just digest it and ingest all the word of God that they can. All the word of God that they can. Father, we believe this in Jesus' name, Father. Believe this, Father. We speak at eyes right now, Lord. Anyone with just failing eyesight that needs a touch in their eyes, or maybe blind in one eye, or blind, Father, we pray right now that they are healed, Father, in Jesus' name. Thank you, God, for the testimonies and the word of God that you've given us, that we can overcome by the blood of the Lamb and the word of their testimonies. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen.
Anybody? Hallelujah. Amen. Is anybody else need a touch from God? This is your turn right now. This is your chance.